All right, so we're looking at number 5, and let's make sure the marker is low enough. There we go. It's really this, 2x squared plus 2x minus 12 over x minus 2. On the top, you can factor out a 2 and be left with x squared plus x and then minus 6. So going back to the top, you can factor that as x plus 3 and then x minus 2. So the x minus 2 on the bottom and the top cancel out. So you would end up with this, e. On number 9, here's a coordinate plane, poorly drawn. And the point that's the center of the circle is over 4 and down 5. So we'll go right here. That's 4, negative 5. And there's a circle that is tangent to the y-axis. That's even more poorly drawn. Alright, so if the circle is tangent to the y-axis and the center of the circle is 4, negative 5, that means you have to go 4 this way and then down to get to it, so the radius would have to be 4, which is A. Number 10, angle A is an acute angle and sine A is 11 over 14. What is the value of cosine A? We'll just draw you a right triangle like this. And let's make this angle A. So if that's angle A and sine A is 11 over 14, that's opposite over hypotenuse. Then what is the value of cosine A? Well, we have to figure out what's missing in there. So you have to do this squared plus whatever this is, we'll call it x, x squared equals 14 squared. So that all that comes out to is x equals the square root of 196 minus 121 when you do the Pythagorean theorem. And 196 minus 121, that's going to be, what is that, 70, is that 75? Yeah. Okay, so 75. You can simplify the square root of 75 to 5 square root of 3. So if I make this 5 square root of 3, and I'm looking for cosine A, it's going to be this over this. So it's 5 square root of 3 over 14, which is... I believe this one's C. On 11, you know when it says what are the values of A and B, if any, where A, or where negative A times the absolute value of B plus 4, close that value, is greater than 0. You know that they're not looking for a specific number for A, because you look at the choices,
yeah,
and there's nothing in there. So if you go down through and guess and check, and we could do that for every one of the possibilities here, but it would take quite a while. But if you can narrow it down, one way to do it is to look at the B values that they give you, which I didn't mean to mark that one out. What was that? Was that a negative 4? I don't know. It's an incorrect choice anyway. But if you put in 4, you can go backwards by putting in a positive 4, which was one of the possibilities over here. And if I put in a positive 4, I'll zoom in. If I put a 4 in there, that would give me an 8. And then a negative something times a positive 8 is not going to be greater than 0. So it's not going to work out with that. So go back and look at your choices. And all of the ones that are positive 4 are not possible. I can't remember if... what this was in here, because I marked it out. Let's see if the x will take it out. It was a negative 4, and that was a positive 4. So that one's gone. That one's out of there. So all you have to do for this one is to go back and plug in what the question is giving you as a possible answer. If A is greater than 0, and B not equal to negative 4, pick out values that satisfy that, like 2 is greater than 0, and B is not equal to negative 4, you can choose another number. And then do the same thing for this one and this one, and just pick values that satisfy each one of those conditions. And when you do that, you'll find that this is the one that can only be true, that works out for you. We're just going to make an example of finding an angle. So here's a right triangle, and I have angle A. We'll say angle A is going to be what we're looking for. But we know this is 3, and this is 12. So the triangle's not drawn to scale, clearly. So if I have to find that missing angle, what I know is that cosine of angle A is going to be adjacent 3 over hypotenuse 12. But to go back and find that angle, what you would do is hit on your calculator, which is like 6 feet away from me. Here it is. Now, you would put in second cosine. Hit the second button and then cosine. And then put in 3 divided by 12 and hit enter. And you'll come back with 75.5 degrees. So on this problem, the ABC is equilateral, AH is perpendicular to BC and has a length of 2 square root of 3 inches. Alright, so we'll go here and do 2 square root of 3. Right triangles. Alright, so from there we know that this is going to be equal to this, and this is equal to that. So with right triangle and all this other stuff here, we know that BC is also equal to BA and AC. The key to this problem is, what is the degree measurement of each angle in an equilateral triangle?
45.
No.
4. Yeah.
All three angles have to be equal in an equilateral triangle.
60.
60 is right. So we know we would have to have a 60 here, a 60 there, but this one is 60 all the way across, but this one here would be what?
30.
30, yes. Do you remember the requirements for 30, 60, 90 triangles? How do you get the short leg, the long leg, and the hypotenuse? All right, so here it is in blue. 30 degrees, the side opposite of that is the short leg. The other side is the long leg, and of course this is what?
Hypotenuse.
To go from the short leg to the long leg, you have to multiply this by square root of 3 to get the long leg. So they've set this one up really neat for you. If I have to multiply this by square root of 3 to get this, what was the short leg to begin with?
2.
2 is right. So we have that. And the hypotenuse, whether or not you'll need this, probably not, but you can find it anyway. The short leg is half the distance of the hypotenuse. Hypotenuse is 4. Alright, so the base, since this right here is 2, what's the length of the entire base? 4, right. So the area of a triangle is 1 half base, which in this case is 4, times height, 2 square root of 3 from there. And you just have to multiply that out. This would give you a 2, and then times that would be 4 square root of 3.
That's what we call a lucky guess.
Now if I could just find the solutions, there we go. 4 square root of 3. If you were to graph this, here's a rough sketch, very rough, of the xy coordinate plane. And let's say that x equals negative 2 is what we graph first. That's a vertical line through negative 2. And then you have 2x plus 3y equals 5. If you wanted to graph that, then you would convert it to slope-intercept form. So really quick, you would just get y by itself. You solve it in terms of y, so it would be a negative 2/3 x plus 5/3, which is 1 2/3. So it crosses at 1 2/3, and then which is really a little bit further up. And then down 2 and to the right 3. So it would be something like this. Missed the point altogether, but oh well, it's a rough script, a sketch. But to solve it, you could do it algebraically. And normally what you do is when you have an equation like that and one like that, you set them as a system of equations and solve it. But this problem has set it up such that it's already mostly done for you. Because what you would do if it were two problems just like this one, you would end up... you'd have to eliminate.
Yeah.
Eliminate and get one variable by itself and then plug it back in.
You can just plug it in. -2 -4.
Right.
4 + 3 y = 5. You're gonna -4 - 5 = 1. And divide by 3 y = 1/3.
And let's see, that would be a 9.
Okay.
Yeah, because you'd move this over and make it +4, so that's 9. So y would be 3. So the point would be 2, 3, and it is -2, 3. So it's E. E is the choice. On problem 20, here's a trapezoid, crudely drawn, as with all of the drawings on here. So we'll go there and there. And it says that an altitude of 15 inches, this is the altitude, an area of 105, and one of the bases is 22 inches. We don't know which, but you can't go wrong by just picking it out. If you choose the wrong base, then it just means that you switch it around. And you don't even need to know that for the answer to the problem. So let's say if I chose to the top is 22 and we solve for a 37, then we had it right. If the top is 22 and we solve for a 10, that's the shorter one. It should have been on top. So it doesn't really matter. So we know we have to have 1/2 the base, or 1/2 the height, and that's going to be times 15. So then we have base 1, we'll just make that one 22, and then we'll solve for base 2, like that. And it's all got to be equal to 105. So we're going to have to do this out here to get a 7.5, and then 22 plus B2. And all that equal to 105. Distribute this times that. So 7.5 times 22 is 165. And then plus 7.5 B2 equals 105. Running out of room all the way around here. So I'll shorten it and go to the right. We need to have 7.5 B2 equals 105 minus 165. So we've just discovered that once you get this negative value over here, that's not going to be possible. So answer would be E, and that is right. This is like the other problem where you have to plug in stuff and just test the possibilities. Why don't we choose 1 for X and 3 for Y? Because that would satisfy the conditions. So what if we put 1, and we'll try this one. Why don't we put 1 in for x, so 1 less than x times y divided by 2, so that would be 1.5, and then y is 3. Does that work out?
Yeah.
Well, that's it. We got lucky. It was the first one we tried, so the rest of these would not work out. We have to go to the next page, but 24, here's the graph. This is a graph of this, and you're supposed to use that as a way to figure out what this would be. So you just have to see, kind of look at this. This is a positive 2 on top, so we're going to be looking for one that has something that represents a negative 2. And then for the absolute value, whenever you put something in, it changes. So what if I put in a 4? I'd get back a 1. And then if I put in a What did I say? I put in a 1, I get back a negative 2. Is that what I said? I can't even remember. I lost my train of thought. My gosh. Okay, let's say we put in 1, and I would get back a negative 2, which would change to positive 2. So it could be all different kinds of things, usually one on either side when you put it in. So we'll go to the next page and see what we have over there to choose from. All right, here's 24 continued, and we have to figure out which one represents that one. So we'll go back and look at this one, but it won't show up on the video. So I wrote the original equation here, negative 2 over the absolute value of x minus 3. We know from looking at the graph before what it was when it's just the quantity of x minus 3. But remember that you can get the same output from an absolute value from two different inputs. You can get the same output. So x value, if you look at the coordinate plane, here's the x. That's the x-axis. So I could possibly put in something that is over here on this side of the x and get back a value that is the same as a totally different value that I put in from the left side on the x-axis. Is what graph on there represents something that would display putting in two different values but still getting back the same thing from the x-axis? You thought it was B. Okay, here's the difference. With B, the main parts of the graph are up here in this quadrant and this quadrant. And remember that we now have this to deal with. We have a negative 2. So no matter what answer comes back on the bottom, just look at the denominator. I marked it out again. I thought I had the laser pointer. But whatever I put in here, the result that comes out of these absolute value brackets will have what sign?
Positive.
So the value of the entire fraction is going to have what because of this?
It's going to be C.
C is right. Yes, because everything you get back is going to be negative from the entire fraction. And look at this. These are both in the negative area only of the y-axis. So you're plugging in x values that could be anything, but they're all the y values have to be negative. And when you put in something on one side, you could get the same value on the other because it's an absolute value. So C is right. Well, number 32, N students in a school, and R percent among the students are 12 years or younger. So we have N in a school. So R percent. If I wanted to find out how many students in the school are 12 years or younger, I would multiply the N times R over 100. And that would give me the number of students in the school that are 12 years or younger. But I'm looking for the ones that are 12 years or older. So if I come out with a value here from this, I would have to do something to it that's a subtraction. Now it depends on how you do this. When you do this here, the reason why I put R over 100 is that it will create a decimal. So that decimal multiplied by N is going to give me the number of students younger than 12. So if I wanted the number of students that are older than 12, then I would have to do the following. I don't want R over 100 as a percent. Like I don't. This is a percent, so what I want to do is this. I want to do 100 minus R, and then that over 100, and then multiply it by N. So let's say I had 32% were 12 years or younger. In order to find out the percent that are 12 years or older, I would do 100 minus 32, which would give me 68. And that's where this comes into play here. That's why that is 100 minus R. But we're doing the decimal version, though. This whole thing here is going to create a decimal. And this should be an equal sign, or at least an arrow right there. They're not all bunching together. So now, which one over there represents that? If I make this a set of parentheses here, n times this set, and then divided by 100, looks to me like it's going to be E. 32 is indeed E.